of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Good and loving God, we thank you for all of your gifts. We thank you for sending the Son in our human nature as Savior, as he who reconciles us to you. We thank you for the way that we partake of that gift of reconciliation and salvation through the sacramental life of the Church. We pray as we gather this night that our own hearts would be open to your wisdom, that our minds would be illuminated by your truth, and that we would have a greater desire to give you ourselves in return for your love for us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Tonight's topic is, what's the matter with sacraments? And I have to admit, my little punny sentence there, at least it's meant to be punny, I don't necessarily know that I'm going to answer that question as directly as it's written, but hopefully you'll catch on that sacraments matter. Tonight, what I want to do is, in addition, of course, of teaching you kind of, or reviewing as it probably is, more apropos-y, what the sacraments really are, or why we have them, I'm hoping that tonight will kind of open up hearts to want to recognize, first of all, how much God loves us, but then secondly, for us to see in our own life how we can love God in return, even through the sacraments. And I say it that way because some of what I want to present tonight is, again, kind of an appealing to the conventional wisdom of our time and the fact that sacraments mean different things to different people. But to start this, and I would ask that those with whom I've already discussed this in the last week would allow others to try to answer the question. Outside of Christmas and Easter, what do you think the 2 days of the year are that more people come to Mass than on the other days? So we're going to put Christmas and Easter in their own category, because that's pretty obvious. But what do you think the other two might be? And I don't have any official proof of this. This is more just observation.
Ash Wednesday?
Good Friday?
Not Good Friday. Somebody said it.
Palm Sunday.
Why do you think that is? Ash Wednesday and Palm Sunday.
They get something.
Exactly. And why do I start there? From that perspective of, again, because they get something that they, whether they take it home and enshrine it in a important place in their house, as the case is with the palms, or, you know, the ashes being that real visible sign. We have in our human nature this attraction, as it were, this sense of wanting visible, tangible stuff as, in this case, real proof of having prayed in the sense of going to Mass or having been close to God. And indeed, I would open tonight by saying this is exactly the kind of sentiment that Jesus probably was appealing to in his own preaching in a lot of ways when he would use the various parables and the imagery that people could identify with. But it's also why he established the sacraments as the way to give us salvation. Because there is that tangible, touchable, sometimes audible, even though those ones, admittedly, are not always the most well-received ones. We'll come back to that, perhaps. But certainly, any of the sacraments that involve taste, like the Eucharist, touch, such as the laying on of hands and ordination, the pouring of the waters of baptism, etc. They have that tangible sign to them. And it's very much a means by which the Lord is appealing to our human nature, as it were. And so the next heading there, sacraments and human nature, and I put nature in italics simply because I want to emphasize the fact of not simply our own humanity, but the whole of creation here, that our material being indeed was exactly what God wanted us to have when he created us, but we aren't simply material beings, nor are we simply spiritual beings. We're a both and, you know, we're not what the philosophers would call dualistic, as though you can separate the soul from the body, but mysteriously, only in the manner that God himself could do it, our soul and our body are one, and there's no separation in them. And God, in his wisdom, chose to nurture us and bring us to himself through a manner that could appeal to both soul and body, and hence we will have the sacraments. But before we get to a more, shall we say, kind of teasing out what sacraments really are and what they mean and why they matter, might I begin with kind of maybe calling out some of the challenges we face, whether it's we who gather tonight or people we know or, you know, the world at large. What is our human tendency? And this is not as God wanted it, but due to the fall, due to original sin, our human tendency is, rather than to allow God to fulfill us as he promised to do and to give us truly everything we ever needed, our tendency is just as it was for Adam and Eve before they fell and ate the forbidden fruit, was to not trust God. And rather than believing and accepting that he will give us what we truly need, we want to strive at times for our own fulfillment, our own sense of completion. Even believers, we are at times guilty of this. And a few ways that might be more particularly teased out for us is to think about our own religious acts as sacraments, how easy it is. And I don't want to point fingers tonight again. I'm just kind of pointing out observations that I've had, and for that matter, others. You know, when it comes to the religious acts that we commit in the sacraments, let's say, how often it is that we believe that these actions receive their power from what we do, from what we add to them. And I've even used this, and it might come up again, new flock, the old images can be used again. I've in the past, on First Communion Sundays, have been known to say that sometimes we treat the sacraments like merit badges, as though we do what we're supposed to do to earn them, the way that, you know, whatever organization, I think of Cub Scouts, seeing I dabbled with them for a few years as a grade school boy. You know, you do the work in your book, and then you're presented with your badge. And I think especially, maybe not First Communion as much, but especially with confirmation, there's this merit badge mentality, as though I earn this. And now that I earn this, and I'm quote unquote an adult in the church, now don't need to do anything anymore. I heard a voice say, now I'm done. Amen. You know, the fact is, we have this, and our culture feeds right into it. Does it not, in terms of, unless you're pulling your weight, unless you're doing your thing, you're not living up to what it means to be an American, let's say. We put so much stock on our own effort that things that are meaningful only have such meaning because of what we did to give it meaning. This is one tendency. another, and I put and or there, because sometimes these go together, but other times this is a whole separate deal, is that we might wholeheartedly reject that the sacraments, that religion altogether, even matters. Because why? We can do it better on our own. Why am I going to go sit there for an hour and listen to a boring homily, if they even call it a homily, and, you know, receive something and not feel any different when I go home? But when I'm out in the woods on my deer stand, or when I'm in the boat, or when I'm in my knitting room, or whatever, that's when I really can pray and feel close to God. And so we wholeheartedly reject what I will propose, and basically not propose on my own, it's the church's faith, what God does for us in the sacramental life. We reject it thinking our own human way of doing it is better for us. And this is, these are things we have to confront, I'm afraid. It's not going to be easy necessarily, and it's going to take very much a personal witness, more than just things we say to people, but albeit, this is what we face. And my third bullet there perhaps is a little bit smarmy, but so be it. Since when, however, do sacraments depend on us? You know, this is our challenge, to look into our hearts. But when we consider from the other direction here, beginning at the top, when God created, as mentioned, he created us as he did, this unity of body and soul in his image and likeness. But in addition to creating us, of course, is the whole of creation. Everything invisible, which most typically we would understand as the realm of the angels. And then, of course, everything visible. And truly, everything that God created has the capacity to show something of who he is, something of his glory, something of what it truly means to live in God, etc. Everything has this capacity. Now, we don't go the whole way and say that, well, God is in everything. He's in this tree, he's in that rock. That, of course, was a heresy. But albeit, we recognize that everything that God willfully accomplishes expresses something of his divine life, of his glory, of his truth. And when it comes then to our nature as this unity of an immortal soul in a material body that, because of the fall, once again, is now subject to decaying and to dying, we, for our part, in a certain way, long for that glory of God. But sometimes we don't know how to find it. And that's where, again, sometimes our own human fallenness takes over. And if I do this, or if I have that, then I'm going to be truly happy. But St. Augustine teaches us an important lesson with his little, very much a often quoted expression here, when he says that our hearts are restless until they rest in thee, that our true fulfillment is only in God. And so when it comes to how are we fulfilled, it's going to be something that God accomplishes in us and for us, and not because we have attained something or we have been able to fulfill ourselves, as it were. And all of this becomes very real and, for lack of a better way of putting it, very upfront when God willingly chooses to take on our own human nature. Jesus, as we know him, the Son of God, he was in the eternal glory of heaven. He, in union with the Father and the Holy Spirit, there was nothing lacking. But then God created, of course, and in time after the fall and after establishing the covenants of old, God wills to come down from his glory, to enter our human nature. He left behind, and in some of Paul's letters, he'll talk about some of this, or the letter to the Hebrews, for example, is another example of God leaving behind the glory of heaven and becoming lower than the angels for a little while. And this is a great act of love. Why would anyone want to leave the true fulfillment, the true perfection that heaven is, to come down here where things are so messed up? And not only are things messed up, but by coming down here, he's going to be subjecting himself to have to die. And I believe this is one of the things that Bishop Sheen used to talk about, that when God willed to become, take on our human nature, he was essentially willing to die. Because indeed, this is the condition we are subjected to. But within that, he is going to be able to restore, to reunite, to bring about the true fulfillment. And so he comes to reconcile us with himself, but through the human nature. And why is that important? Because already we're talking about a realm of the sacraments. God could have waved his divine hand over the whole creation and accomplished salvation. Could have he not? But he wills to take on flesh, material, our material existence. And the sacraments, if there is no incarnation, there are no sacraments, period. And this, risk I say it, is one of the things that causes some challenges, I would say, in some of our dialogue with Protestants. Because some of them don't think of Jesus' incarnation the way we do. And if you don't have the incarnation right, you can't get the sacraments right. But once you believe that God willingly, without leaving any of his divinity, only the glory of heaven is left behind, but in the fullness of his divinity, he takes on humanity. Indeed, you have the foundation of a sacramental system, if you would. And a couple of scripture quotes, one which we hear Christmas morning, and the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we saw his glory as the glory, or the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. From his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace, because while the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. The divine life of God takes on flesh and willingly bestows that upon us. And then the Hebrews 14-16, this was the passage from 2 days ago. Since we have a great high priest who is able to sympathize, I've paraphrased a little bit here, able to sympathize with our weaknesses, as he has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. This is the power of our Lord in taking on our humanity. He's able to give us divine life. And then a more contemporary voice, our Holy Father, his encyclical, Laudato Si, which if you listen strictly to the media, it's all about climate change or it's all about the environment. But in truth, it's all about stewardship and theology. And toward the end of the encyclical, he says this, and this kind of points back to what I said earlier about the whole of creation has the capacity to share or to show something of God's glory. He says, the universe unfolds in God who fills it completely. Hence, there is a mystical meaning to be found in a leaf, in a mountain trail, in a dewdrop, in a poor person's face. The ideal is not only to pass from the exterior to the interior to discover the action of God in the soul, but also to discover God in all things. He's pointing in a very real way to the fact that everything that God made has that capacity to show something of the glory of God. And through it, we can be drawn more fully into the life of God. And so to go backwards here, do we want to shun the person who says, I pray better in my deer stand, or I pray better in, you know, when I'm in the boat? By no means, because they're pointing to a truth. But so long as that truth remains in the realm of I'm doing it my own way, they're missing something. But if that truth humbly acknowledges that God is in charge of all of this. And God doesn't want me to see him only here, because clearly he does want me to see him here. But he's inviting me to not only see him, but to be drawn into his life through the Eucharist, through reconciliation, through baptism, through confirmation. Then we got it right. All these things are integrated, as it were. So far, so good?
Yep.
So what then are sacraments? In the Catechism, in paragraph 1131, and no pressure, Grace, but when I was going through my master's in liturgy program, my teacher on sacraments says, yeah, I make all my junior high students memorize this quote from the Catechism, which had me as a, probably how long ordained had I been, like 6 years ordained priest at the time, thinking, uh-oh, I've got homework to do. If eighth graders have this memorized and a priest doesn't. At any rate, this is probably the most concise definition of sacrament that the Catechism gives in terms of its section on sacraments. It says, the sacraments are efficacious signs of grace instituted by Christ, entrusted to the church, by which divine life is dispensed to us. The visible rites by which the sacraments are celebrated signify and make present the graces proper to each sacrament. They bear fruit in those who receive them with the required dispositions. Okay, so there's a lot going on in that paragraph. For now, what I want to emphasize is that first sentence. They are efficacious signs of grace. Some of you might remember the old Baltimore Catechism. Sacraments are outward visible signs of invisible grace. That little expression there is kind of combining both of those phrases. Efficacious signs of grace. In other words, to be a sign is already pointing to something that's tangible, that you can see, that you can hear, that you can feel or taste. But they are efficacious in the reality that they are more than just what appearances belie. They contain real power, real life within them. They are effective at communicating what they are meant to communicate. Did I say that right?
Yes.
they carry it out as it's meant to be carried out. That they are instituted by Christ. This is very plain. It's our understanding of the faith from day one that Jesus instituted the sacraments. And we could go off a whole night on just what that really means. The short version is basically this. That when we use the words that Jesus instituted the sacraments, we don't necessarily mean that he sat down and formulated every little jot and tittle of how they're going to be carried out. What's more important than that is that their power come from him. That they have no other source than Jesus. And we'll be coming back to that. That they are entrusted to the church. The church is given the sacraments as their not only custodians, but as the true dispenser of them. And then finally, by which divine life is dispensed to us. God gives us himself through the sacraments according to the particular graces of each sacrament, because of course we have seven different sacraments and their effects are distinct from one another, but they are all sources of divine life. And then the rest of the paragraph there, the visible rites by which the sacraments are celebrated. Again, they signify and make present the graces proper to each sacrament. What I basically just said about the divine life being real but distinct in each of them. And then they bear fruit. They have a real effect in those who receive them with the required dispositions. And we'll come back to that one too a little bit later. Now, these are signs that really matter. Why do they really matter? Well, let's think about what a sign is for a minute. Here we go. Here's a sign, right? What do signs normally do?
Tell you what to do.
They tell you something. So let's see, your donation helps defray the cost of the deacon's next retreat.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so your donation helps defray the cost of dinner. Thank you. Now, does this sign itself help defray the cost of dinner?
No.
If I gave this to the pizza joint, would they accept it as payment?
No.
No. But it points us to carry out something, in this case, that will help accomplish what this sign is indicating. Another example is a road sign. You know, out here on the traffic signal poles, two of them say Kenwood Avenue, the other two say Arrowhead Road. Are those signs the actual Kenwood Avenue and the Arrowhead Road? No, the pavement is, that you go and drive on top of. That's the actual road. Those signs are simply pointing you to the reality of the two streets there. It's different with the sacraments. They're signs in the fact that they point. I suppose now is as good a time as any to cue what we tread upon a week ago. And by the way, for those who are running the gauntlet here, my little pictures aren't going to go away because they have application really in every session, not necessarily in the same way either. So, except tonight, I think we're going to skip right to the Catholic model. We're not going to worry about the other one, assuming our projector will heat up quickly. Because our signs, what are they really going to be pointing to, do you think, before the picture comes up, seeing you have it in front of you? Where are we going?
Heaven,
right? So what do these signs point to? They point towards heaven. Are the signs heaven?
No.
They are efficacious signs, right? So they communicate that which they also point to. And so, hence, going back to our little picture, my two little swoopy down arrows that point back up towards the church there. God is coming down from heaven and making himself present in the sign. So whereas the signs for our parish, the signs for the beef dinner, the signs for the roads out here, they simply point you to another reality that lies either beyond them or literally under your feet in the case of the roads. These signs contain the reality within them. And this is by God's design. He who has the power to, again, endow all of creation with the capacity to show something of his glory, he wills to, through particular elements of creation, and this is part of the beauty of the sacramental system as well, when you think of what we use in the sacraments, we're not talking about things that are rare or beyond the capacity of most human beings to have access to. Certainly when we think of water, our life depends on it. And so every human being better have access to a fitting amount of water. So you have an element there that's very common, very plain, but yet through it, God is able to give his life to us. Bread. And again, we could argue over, well, not every culture eats bread the way that, say, people in Europe and in America and so forth. But the fact is, the bread that we eat is wheat flour and water baked. So it's very plain and very, again, very accessible in that regard. Wine, and certainly different cultures have access to wine to the degree that they're able. But a very common food item, and certainly very, very common in the culture within which our faith was truly fulfilled for us in our Lord's incarnation, in the land that God gave his chosen people. You know, these are elements that were very common. And we could go on from there, the oil. And, you know, typically we use olive oil, but that doesn't exclude other kinds of vegetable oil that could be used when necessary for the oil of the sick, for the chrism oil for confirmation and holy orders and so forth. So there's real things as they were, but endowed by God with his power within them. And so sacramental signs, they do more than point. They also contain something of the end goal within them. And then here's this Latin expression, ex opere operato. By the work worked is the literal translation here. And I have this on the, I guess I'm blocking, I'm not in a good place, am I? So this second point here, that worship is sacramental, God's grace is effective through the ritual. Realize we are not talking about some sort of magical spell that is placed on these elements. Even though many in the day, everybody knows the expression hocus pocus. Well, a quick lesson. If you remember the days of old, or maybe the days of not so old, but albeit have enough familiarity with the Mass being offered in Latin, the priest would say, hoc est enim corpus meum. Hoc, this. That word in Latin led some who were against the church to develop the word hocus pocus as kind of a Catholic slam. So there is no hocus pocus here. This is all about something that Jesus Christ wills. And realize too that when we talk about this ex opere operato, that because God is the one willing it, when we human beings cooperate in the proper way with what has been handed on to us by the church from Christ himself, they have their power not because of anything we did other than cooperate. Their real power, once again, comes from Christ. And this is, again, one of the linchpin realities in terms of what separates us, unfortunately, because we don't want to talk about separation as something we're glad about. But sadly, there are many Christians who don't even have the ears to hear what we're talking about tonight, because to them it's an unheard of thing or objectionable before they even, you know, hear the first syllable. But when we think about, once again, who's really in charge, it's God, and God wills to communicate himself in these ways, and when we cooperate with him, indeed, his will is fulfilled. And so when it comes to the Holy Mass, the consecration of the bread and wine that become our Lord's body and blood, it's simply this, that the validly ordained priest offers the Mass according to the rite that the church has handed on with the right intention. If those things are in place, we have the Eucharist. It doesn't matter if the priest is in a state of mortal sin, quite honestly. If he's in a state of mortal sin, he's just putting his own soul in greater peril. But as for those who are receiving communion from him, they're receiving valid communion. Because by the work being done, it is done. Ex opere operato. And this is true of all of our sacraments. It depends not on the what we call worthiness of the minister. It depends simply on employing and carrying out the ritual in the way that it has been handed on to us and according to the truth of what the rite is meant to be. So again, the signs have real effect. And when I talk about all of their power come from Jesus Christ, they come from him because of what he accomplished in redeeming us. And so at the heart of the matter isn't simply, even though, like I say, if we don't have the incarnation right, we can't get the sacramental system correct. But once we have Jesus, Son of God, who took on our humanity, it's through his passion, death, resurrection, ascending to heaven, the sending of the Holy Spirit, what we call the Paschal mystery, that, as it were, this power of God is made accessible to us. And it is that power that truly is to be found within the sacraments. Once again, according to each proper sacrament. So let's think about baptism in this context for a minute, because it's perhaps the most simple example. When we think about baptism, of course, we are washed with the water, and like any washing with water, hopefully we're cleaner once we're washed. But in this case, it's not simply about physical cleanliness. It's rather about the grace that God offers through that washing, which in this case is the forgiveness of sin, and in particular, the forgiveness of the original sin. But we don't limit it to just the original sin. It's the forgiveness truly of all sin. This is why when adults are baptized, they don't need to go to confession first, because all their sins, simply through the washing of water, are taken away. And this is the clearest kind of connection to the passion in that sense. And in fact, last Sunday's reading, can you be baptized with the baptism which I will be baptized with? This is exactly what Jesus is talking about. By his death, indeed, this is what will free them from sin and free us from our sin. And accordingly, our sharing in his baptism is a sharing in his death, as St. Paul says in Romans. And just like he was raised up, so too we are raised up through baptism. And so this is the grace that's at work, rooted in his passion, death, resurrection. Obviously, the Eucharist has similar dynamics in terms of the sacrifice of our Lord's body on the cross, now made present to us sacramentally in a unbloody and nonviolent manner, as the Council of Trent from the 16th century articulated it for us. And indeed, what we receive there is not Jesus's dead body on the cross, as it were, but the resurrected body, his new life. His offering brought about new life. And so our partaking of the Eucharist is a partaking in his very life itself. Now for the good part, at least I think it's the good part. What I have there as sacraments and relationship with God and neighbor. This is my tie back to Sunday. I said to a few people before I started that you might not hear my connection when I sort of shamelessly made a plug for tonight on Sunday Mass. But here's where I'm going with what I said on Sunday in terms of my repetitive insistence on what God wants to do for us that I made over the weekend. Amen. God wants to give us his life. God wants us to be eternally with him forever in heaven. But the question comes down to, is our own heart in the right place? Are we open to receiving what he wants to give us on the one hand? And here is where we can talk about a proper disposition for the sacraments. As you know, the church doesn't sort of willy-nilly offer the sacraments. There are certain parameters by which we do the things we do. Why? Because they are acts of faith. And so, you know, if I were to round up people from the shopping center across the way and just start baptizing them, for some of them it might not mean anything. For others, they'd say, "What are you doing? I already had this when I was young." What have you. But albeit, disposition is important and necessary, that it's proper. And so, using the baptism example, what is the proper disposition for baptism? Actually, this is one of the easy ones. Faith, and that they haven't been baptized before. That's basically the requirement for baptism. Those two things. Not necessarily in that order. What is the proper disposition for the sacrament of penance? That we're aware of sin in our life and we're sorry for it. And this is really one of the interesting things, because if I were to go more, shall we say, Baltimore Catechism-ish on you tonight, I'd talk about things like the form of the sacrament and the matter of the sacrament. And I've already been talking about matter, hence the title, what's the matter with sacraments? In the case of confession, what's the matter? It's actually the sins. The priest sits in the chair, and what is he listening for? He's listening for a confession of sin. Once a sin has been confessed, there is proper matter by which the sacrament can become truly effective. If no sin is confessed, which, risk I say, does happen, people will come in, "Father, it's been a year since my last confession, and I've been sick, and I'm tired," and they start talking about, you know, their tales of woe, risk I call them that, at the risk of sounding insensitive, but they start just talking about their problems. And we sit there and say, okay, not one thing they've said in the last 4 minutes was truly a confession of sin. And then we try to work with them and say, well, is there something you remember, even a venial sin? But once that venial sin is confessed, there's right matter for the sacrament to be effective. And so disposition matters. The synod on the family occurring these last few weeks and concluding the end of this week. Disposition of the sacraments is at the very heart of the turmoil. Are those who are married, divorced, and remarried, are they in the right disposition to receive communion? Especially since the Lord said, the one who divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. And it's that plain in the scriptures. And there are those who want to kind of wiggle around the truth there. But frankly, and I'm not saying we're happy about this, but there is no possibility of someone who is invalidly married because they were divorced. There is no possibility for them having the right disposition for Holy Communion in this life. Sad, but true. And the work of the synod, and this is why we're praying for them, is so that they would help us to recognize, how can we walk with these people? How can we help them to have a relationship with God, even though their life has taken a turn that it has? Many of them not wanting to do the wrong thing. I mean, I can tell you, and I don't know enough people here yet to know this, but in my former assignment, when I would look out on Sunday morning and see who couldn't come up for communion, even though I spoke of receiving the Eucharist and the power of the Eucharist pretty much in every Sunday homily through the years, it tore at my heart, because it's like, these are people that they want to do the right thing. And they, in the sense of a lot of the visible things they gave themselves to, in terms of, I can think of one couple, they have two teenage children together, but he had been previously married before they got married wherever they did. It wasn't in the church, of course, unfortunately, because of the first marriage situation. They were trying to do everything right, but yet they're not in that right place yet. So how can we walk with them? How can we help them? This is the issue of the synod, and why we need to pray and, you know, have true compassion, not a false compassion that says, well, it doesn't really matter, let's just pretend it's not there, or if you tell me that you're sorry for it, then that's good enough, even though there's still that objective problem in place. You know, these are the circumstances. So we have to have that right disposition. But then we have, what does faith mean in this context? And this is where, again, I want to kind of appeal to everyone in this room, myself included, because I'm not always as attentive to sacramental ministry as I could be, both in the sense of being willing to be bothered when somebody says, Father, would you hear my confession? Or, Father, could you come and anoint my mother, father, grandparent? Sometimes I kind of go, oh, I've got 8 other things to do and now this. That's not a good attitude, Father. So we're not immune to this either. But the reality is this is a call to love. And if we have true faith, hopefully we're open to growing in that love. It's one of the reasons why I went on the whole amen kick on the weekend. Because that amen that we say with communion, even if some days it is more rote and routine and we're preoccupied because of the 82 other things that are going on in our life or in our family, so long as we're open to continuing to grow in a deeper love for the Lord, a deeper love for our neighbor, amazing things happen in the sacraments. And so, relationship. And this is the point I want to emphasize. We're talking about God drawing us closer to himself, God enabling us to love one another in a more proper way. And so we continue on that journey, and hopefully we're open to that and not just doing it because that's what we have to do. That's what we were taught as a kid, what have you. And then the proper effects of the sacraments. Again, I think I've said in a roundabout way, enough on that in terms of they give their effect according to what they are, according to when they're given, etc. So finally, through the sacraments, God gives us life. And I have, at this point, once more to the illustrations. So we have the reality. We've talked about the signs. I haven't really talked about the word symbol that much tonight. Ooh, I'm out of time. Symbol is just another level of sign, in a sense. When we talk about symbols, we're talking about signs that contain, as it were, a multitude of meaning. And so, to the extent that, you know, the sacraments are signs that point to heaven, that's their primary meaning in terms of what they're pointing to and then what they contain within them. But they also have this element of symbol because each of them, you know, we don't want to limit the meaning of the sacraments, if that makes sense. Because after all, their source is infinite life himself. And so we don't limit, or we ought not limit, the sacraments. And in this way, they take on the nature of symbol because they're able to contain and convey many realities of truth, meaning, love, what have you. The important thing, if I haven't said this already in other words, I don't think I've used these words tonight, is that these are objective realities. They are what they are because God has given them to us. They are the truth. They are not subjective realities. And here again, if you go back to the 16th century, some of the reformers had an air of subjectivity to their mentality. It's the real presence if you believe it's the real presence. And only then is it the real presence. No, it's the real presence because of what I said earlier about by the work being done, it is done. So whether we believe it's the real presence or not, it's still the real presence in the Eucharist. And if someone who receives it doesn't believe in the real presence, it's still the real presence. They have still received Jesus Christ. But have they received the graces that Jesus wants them to give? No. In fact, if we follow St. Paul's words in 1 Corinthians 11, they've done that onto their own judgment. Or some translations even say onto their own condemnation. So these are objective realities. And then kind of try to land the airplane here. Later in Laudato Si, the Pope's encyclical, he goes further from what I quoted above and says, The sacraments are a privileged way in which nature is taken up by God to become a means of mediating supernatural life. Through our worship of God, we are invited to embrace the world on a different plane. Water, oil, fire, and colors are taken up in all their symbolic power and incorporated in our act of praise. Hopefully that's a pretty good summary there. Then that last point, and I did this at the risk of not having time to get to it, and besides, there's a typo. It should be paragraph 1677. I was trying to do too much at once or something. 1677, where it basically defines sacramentals. What I'm wearing is a sacramental. Actually, the so-called two-piece is also a sacramental, meaning the dress pants and the clerical collared shirt. Why is it a sacramental? Because it's like a sacrament in that it has sign value, but it's instituted not by Christ, but by the church. And these things help to give us a right disposition for the sacraments. And to give you a better example, well, maybe not a better example, but well, yeah, a better example, Father. To give you a better example of a sacramental, this is one of the reasons I believe in the power of devotion to Our Lady. Because if sacramentals are those realities that help us to have the right dispositions for the sacraments, who better to go to than the one who had the perfect disposition for everything that God wanted to accomplish in her? So she helps us, as will become a cliche that I use a lot, she helps us to become like she is when we have devotion to Mary, opening our heart to what God wants to do in us, just the way she was open. And hence again, back to the homily, why I used her as the example of our amen, so be it. So with that, I'm finally gonna zip it and see if you have questions.
Can you just clarify what the marriage and the remarriage example? Someone who was married and they receive an annulment and then are married in the church, they can validly receive the sacrament.
Yeah, and again, maybe backing up from that even, what's an annulment? An annulment is not a Catholic divorce. It's basically after investigation into what appeared to be a valid marriage. Well, we've got the advocate right here. She should be saying this. No. Carol, you can have the night off. Or you can correct me. It's not an investigation into, you know, whether or not the marriage went bad and therefore we can sort of call it a non-marriage. What it looks at is whether or not the actual contracted marriage, or the marriage covenant, better said, was validly entered into by both parties, freely, without reservation or condition. You know, all of the things, if you know the questions that get asked of every couple that approaches the church asking for marriage, in terms of, are you doing this freely? Are you open to children, etc.? Are there any circumstances in your life that, you know, might prevent you from entering into marriage, such as some kind of mental illness, let's say? All of these things are looked at in terms of, was there anything in play at the time of that original consent that invalidated the consent? Was there another relationship on the side so that when he or she said, I do, they were winking at someone out in the congregation? You know, and I know that sounds silly, but people have bad motivation sometimes. And so that's what's being investigated. And if it's proven that there wasn't a validly contracted marriage or a valid sacrament there, in the case of, you know, if we're talking about two baptized people, because for what it's worth, even people who aren't married in the church get divorced and then want to get married in the church later to someone who is Catholic, let's say, they would need to go through this process too. So it doesn't just apply to Catholics, it applies to all marriages, because we recognize all marriages as valid until proven otherwise. So that being the case, It's an investigation into the consent. Consent makes marriage is the little expression they teach us in sacramental theology. So the consent was valid, but then the couple grows on in years and realize that they really hate each other or something. That doesn't necessarily provide grounds for an annulment, if that makes sense. But once, if in a situation where there is that declaration of nullity granted from a previous marriage, then that person is once more deemed free to marry, and thus they can get married in the church. Or as is often the case, let's say the person is married, divorced, and then they run off to get married somewhere else. But then 10 years later come to their senses and I want to go back to church. And then father says, well, because you're previously married, we have to go through this annulment process. And they grit their teeth, but then they go through with it and it's granted, let's say. Then they and their person who they believe to be their true spouse now, they can have their marriage blessed, or more properly called convalidated by the church, where they have an actual Catholic wedding, albeit in a more perhaps simple manner, but albeit it's the same ceremony, and it validates their more current relationship. And then this opens up the world of the sacraments to them again.
I just wanted to make one other comment. If someone is married in the church and divorced and hasn't remarried or is not remarried, they still can receive the sacrament.
Yes.
Yes.
I just wanted to point that out.
That's the flip side of that coin, so thank you for bringing that up. Yeah, a divorcee can still receive the sacraments.
One of the questions that has been asked of me is what happens with the children, because they're not looking at it as sacramental, but civilly, that is not saying that there wasn't a lawful marriage, right?
Yeah, and what we always teach about that is the reality that when the children came about, there was good faith in at least one of those persons in that marriage. And so they're always seen as legitimate and you know, true, as it were, if you would, because of that fact of the good faith of at least one of those two in that relationship when they were brought about.
What makes a priest validly ordained?
That's a good question too. Because that's part, and I chose not to go there tonight either, but I could have very easily kind of spun this whole thing, you know, us and them. And one of the key issues is holy orders. You know, unfortunately, a lot of our Christian brothers and sisters have rejected holy orders. And I mean, they tend to like to poke at the more surface level stuff of, the scripture says, don't call anyone your father. Well, okay, we can have a conversation about that, but that's not the real issue here. The real issue is, did Jesus Christ will to establish a sacrament of orders by which the other sacraments would be conferred, or is our baptism enough? And our Catholic faith basically teaches about a baptismal priesthood and a ministerial priesthood. And if you come back on the what does it mean to actively participate night, we might be going down this road a little bit more deliberately, because it's a big part of what participation means. To be a member of the baptized versus those chosen from among the baptized, not because they're better or smarter, because certainly God qualifies the unqualified, if I use that expression right. Holy orders is given as a sacrament specifically for the sake of the distribution of the sacraments. And that being what it is, what is it to be validly ordained? It is to be, to have the laying on of hands by a bishop. You know, have after the man has been found properly ready to receive the sacrament. And just so you know, that's changed through the years. Seminaries as we know them today haven't always existed in the history of the church. It was really only after about the 16th century that the formal education of those men who were seeking the ordained life really came into play. But of course, truth being it as it is, ordination is reserved to men. And why only to men? We believe this is one of those circumstances where the Lord made a deliberate choice that he did, and that we don't have the authority to change that or in any way undermine that. Some of you might remember not too long ago, I think it was last winter, when Cardinal O'Malley from Boston was on 60 Minutes and made his little comment that, well, if I were starting a church, I would love to have women priests. And everybody went, oh, what's he saying? Honestly, he was just being a comedian. Because what he was basically saying is that if he, Sean O'Malley, were starting the church, sure, he could do that. But the church was started by Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ made the decision he made. And I always like to add on to this kind of the rebuttal of the argument from cultural circumstance, where those will say, well, Jesus lived in a very patriarchal time, and so he had no choice but to choose men. The fact is, Jesus broke all of the social norms when it came to how he treated women, especially that famous scene of the woman caught in adultery. So he was by no means beholden to the patriarchal society. He was beholden to true love for every human being, male and female. The other thing that can be said about this, and another angle that could have been employed tonight, especially with the little picture, is the imagery of covenant, where in the Old Testament, how often is it that God refers to himself as loving his spouse or his bride? And the reality is, this isn't just about male-female. This is about a true nuptial relationship, where God himself is as the bridegroom, the initiator, the one who offers himself to his bride, who embraces the gift and takes the gift, as it were, but at the same time gives herself. And I mean, this is John Paul II's theology of the body at work right here too. And when it comes to holy orders, who is the priest? He is the one that stands in the place of Jesus Christ, or AKA in the place of the true bridegroom, giving his life for who is the bride? The church. And why Ephesians chapter 5 that we had in late August for Sunday Mass, you know, wives be subordinate to your husbands as to the Lord, etc., is not at all about any kind of patriarchal domination there. It's all about being true in receiving the gift of the bridegroom. Because husbands, love your wives as Christ loves the church. Offer yourself on her behalf. And Paul, how does he conclude that passage? This is a great mystery, he says, but I speak of Christ and the church. So it's kind of flips it on its head. He's using a sacramental image of wife and husband to speak of the eternal image of Christ and his church, and thus that dynamic there, the bridegroom. And so it's fitting. And now, does Jesus go to that depth of teaching in his own words that we have written down in Scripture? No. But it's, again, if you take the fact of it's a choice that he made, and also this deeper theology reflected throughout the Scriptures, and then, of course, throughout the tradition of the church, it's abundantly clear that, indeed, the priest, it needs to be, in this case, reserved to men. So a man who is deemed worthy, because no man has a right to ordination. We all, in a sense, have a right to baptism. People even have a right to be married. But no one has a right to be ordained. Ordination is given only after one is judged, you know, properly fitting with the help of God, as it were, because none of us are truly worthy. But indeed, so long as those entrusted with our training, as it were, I know seating is limited, but if you have a chance, given the circumstance, to be at the deacon ordination next month of Jim Philbin, you're going to hear some of these very words in dialogue between, I don't know who's even going to do the Most Reverend Father, we ask you to ordain these men, our brothers, to service as deacons. And Bishop Paul will say, do you know them to be worthy? And then whoever's up in the pulpit will say, after inquiry with those entrusted with their training and the people of God, or something to that effect, I don't have it memorized, we have indeed found them worthy. And then what does the bishop say? Relying on the help of God and on, you know, the word that you've given us, we do indeed choose these men for the order of diaconate. And then everybody applauds, and then begins the rite of ordination. And so right in the rite, there's that appeal to God's wisdom and faith, as it is. Other questions? Comments? So hopefully this has given you a sense of why the sacraments matter. Mm-hmm. I didn't necessarily circle back to my opening points very well, but hopefully you have a sense that, okay, there's more to this than just us getting up Sunday after Sunday and going to church because Mom taught me to do that or I'd go to hell, or whatever kind of way of catechism we had growing up. But that there's real power, there's real relationship, there's real life here. And the more we live it, I would believe that the more it becomes attractive to a world that's, pardon me for being corny, and this isn't my joke, I've heard other speakers use this, but the country western song that's looking for love in all the wrong places, the more we live it, the more that others are going to say, there's something about them that intrigues me. And then the conversation begins. And then we leave it to the Holy Spirit and God's grace, and who knows, we might have more people coming through the doors. Excellent. Well, why don't we finish with prayer? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Father in heaven, we thank you for the time we have spent. Help us, we pray, to continue in our faith journey with openness to what you want to do for us through your Son, and with the desire to continue to grow in a more perfect response to that love. And mindful of Mary's response, we ask her to help us as we pray. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.